When I was growing up in Port Talbot, South Wales, it seemed that every pub in the town had a photo of Richard Burton and Elizabeth Taylor. There they were, impossibly tanned, mink-coated, landing in their helicopter on the sands of Aberavon Beach, or sitting round a pub table with the locals. They were up there with rugby stars Barry John and JPR Williams, demigods. Every landlord would tell you that theirs was the snug they visited. And in a half-comic, half-deadly serious way, it mattered. And he mattered. I'm Michael Sheen, and over the next hour, I want to rekindle and explore some of that Richard Burton legacy. Rich, they called him down our way. Who he was. And he loomed colossal in my early life. What am I saying? He still does.
Broadsword calling Danny Boy. Broadsword calling Danny Boy.
O God of battles, steal my soldiers' hearts. Possess them not with fear. Take from them now the sense of reckoning if the opposed numbers pluck their hearts from them.
Let's examine it, that glittering, meteoric cause. While the rest of the world is being blown to bits about us, what's the only thing that matters? Me!
Suddenly the desolation, the solitude, became unendurable. While that voice sounded, London had still seemed alive. Now suddenly there was a change, the passing of something, and all that remained was this gaunt quiet.
And you, my father, there on the sad height, curse, bless me now with your fierce tears, I pray. Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light.
The first time I recognized who he was when I was at school, and the film they were showing was Where Eagles Dare. It was the big school film. And there is my uncle, 18 feet high on this enormous screen, and I'm looking at it going, that's my uncle. I had no idea he was so famous.
Actor and director Guy Masterson, one of the people I've called on to get the measure of a man who died only, or already, a quarter of a century ago. Guy was that all-important element in Burton's life. Family.
Richard was my grandmother Sis's second youngest brother. Sis brought him up, and he grew up 2.5 years older than my mum, so they grew up as brother and sister, effectively. So I always called him Uncle Richard, and as I got older, it was Rich.
I think he was given a chance, and he grabbed it, and he ran with it as far as he possibly could.
Sally Burton, the last of Richard's four wives.
It's extraordinary to me that I'm still talking about him at this point, but I have learnt to understand it. I mean, he meant so much to Wales, so very, very much. He was a Welsh warrior, you know? He went out and fought the battle.
Next to the family were the friends, the real friends. Robert Hardy met him as a teenager.
Whatever he did had a greatness about it, a size, a breadth, a strength, which was uncommon. And even, as I've said very often, his mistakes were giant. They were great too.
Subconsciously anyway, in the back of my mind, I've always known when to make an explosion of some kind and make sure it's done in public so that the world knows about it.
Yes, there'll be plenty of the man himself, not just in roaring or romantic or rumbling action, but in interviews throughout his career. And then there's his biographer, Melvin Bragg, who gleaned opinions far wider than we have time for here.
David Lean, who, in my view, is one of the best judges of actors, thought that Burton was the most fantastic screen actor and wanted to work with him, never managed to pull it off. I think when I was working with David at that time, I got a lot of clips together from the Burton films. I was looking through them again and again, and he said, can I have a look at them? And so we should. And David just kept saying, look, you can't take your eyes off him. You can't take your eyes off him. Whoever's on screen, you can't take your eyes off him. Doesn't matter who's there, you can't take your eyes off him.
Those blue-green eyes and that voice, always compelling, whether it was what became the Christmas TV classic Where Eagles Dare or Equus, another film to win him a Best Actor nomination at the Oscars. There were seven in all, without a single win. books are still being written about him. The latest by Nancy Schoenberger and her partner Sam Kushner. A Furious Love is the story of his tempest-torn marriage to Elizabeth Taylor.
That kind of masculinity is no longer the gold standard for masculinity. But I think anyone is going to be susceptible to a man or a woman who has that the kind of sexual magnetism and animal magnetism that Burton had.
I love women, all shapes, sizes. As a matter of fact, you should have seen me sweep through my village this morning. I kissed women from the age of 92 to, and I think I got down to one who was 3.5. I really love their company. I love being with them.
The trouble is they appear to love yours as well.
Some of them do, yes. Can't think why. Maybe because I talk a lot.
He was utterly charming. I always enjoyed going off to spend time with Richard.
Film critic and TV presenter Barry Norman.
It's a dangerous, parlous pastime because he insisted on you drinking with him. And this was a man who could drink for Britain. And what's more, there was no heel tapping with Burton. I mean, when he finished his drink, he'd hand it to one of his acolytes to have it refilled, and you had to finish your drink and have a refill as well, which was all right for the first couple of drinks, but after it got beyond 3 or 4, he was still immaculately sober and articulate, whereas you would be, well, I would be, you know, pretty well falling off the chair.
And Cherry Owen, sober as Sunday, as he is every day of the week, goes off happy as Saturday to get drunk as a deacon, as he does every night.
To begin at the beginning, he was little Richie Jenkins of Taibach.
Robert Hardy, picking up the Under Milkwood theme, the radio play by Dylan Thomas, first broadcast by the BBC back in 1954, with Burton at the centre of it. This programme is about legacy. In part, that means memories. But more especially, it's about the difference Richard Burton made and goes on making. With Under Milkwood still one of the BBC's top-selling CD recordings. After all, it is one of the greatest pieces of theatre ever produced by the BBC on radio or television. It's fair to say he's still finding new audiences. And the reason? Listen.
To begin at the beginning. It is spring, moonless night in the small town, starless and Bible black, the cobble streets silent and the hunched quarters and rabbits wood limping invisible down to the slow black, crow black fishing boat bobbing sea. The houses are blind as moles, though moles see fine tonight in the snouting velvet dingles, or blind as Captain Cat there in the muffled middle by the pump and the town clock, the shops in mourning, the welfare hall in widow's weeds, and all the people of the lulled and dumbfound town are sleeping now.
The poise, the control, the gravel, the easy way with the words, vintage Burton. But to get back to Robert Hardy's point, back at the beginning, he was just Richie Jenkins, a Welsh miner's son, living in the same town that I too had the privilege to come from. In fact, his journey from there to world stardom was so extraordinary that Melvyn Bragg wanted to turn it into a Victorian novel.
The 13th child of a miner, his mother died when she had her 14th child, brought up in what nowadays in this country would be called destitution, mainly by his older sisters and brothers, talked to my publisher about it. And somehow or other, he must have told Sally Burton, or knew Sally Burton, who wrote to me and said, there are all these notebooks which I have never read. They're in Switzerland. Would you like to have a look at them before you start? So, of course, I said yes, and I went out there. And, of course, it ruined my novel, because there was no way I could possibly write about Burton as fiction without having now all this stuff in my mind. They were quite wonderful notebooks. And in the course of reading the notebooks, it was then that I realised he was a much grander and more compelling figure than I'd anticipated. Because I'd got the outline of him, and I'd seen him in films, but I didn't realise the hinterland. And the hinterland was enormous.
The notebooks and diaries which were at Burton's Swiss home, Pays de Galles, Wales in French, are a joy for celebrity watchers of the 60s and 70s, full of meetings with royalty, politicians, and stars of film and stage. There's also personal commentaries on his marriages and his family. And then there are moments when he'll suddenly turn the pen on himself. Here's a flavour from the late 70s. Only our concept of time makes it possible for us to speak of the Day of Judgment by that name. In reality, it is a summary court in perpetual session. That is from a letter of Kafka's. It haunts me. The supreme judge at that severe searching of the soul is oneself. It is I who act, I who do the deed or have the thought, and it's I only who can judge the action or the thought. I am prosecutor and defender, Satan and saint. I am totally responsible for all my sins and goodnesses. And I am alone.
It was decided that I should go and live with my sister, who was married to a miner called Elbert James, who lived in a place called Taibach, and that my little brother, Graham, should go and live with my brother, Tom, who was married and lived in Comaron. And so we left home.
The familiar Welsh enthusiasm for harps and rugby and choirs were all important to Richard, but the heart of his love for the land of his and of my fathers was a woman. Cecilia, or Sis to the family, was the elder sister who took him in as a two-year-old child. She was Guy Masterson's grandmother.
I would consider almost her to be an angel in some strange way. She, as Richard said in his beautiful piece that he wrote about her, my sister was no ordinary woman, no woman ever is, but to me, my sister less than any. When my mother died, she, my sister, became my mother and was more mother to me than any mother could ever have been. I was immensely proud of her and shone in the reflection of her green-eyed, black-haired, gypsy beauty. You know, he wrote this about the Sis, which was, she sang at her work in a voice so pure that the local men said she had a bell in every tooth and was gifted by God. She was innocent and guileless and infinitely protectable, and I knew that I had a bounden duty to protect her above all other species. The love that she exuded was uncomplicated and pure and made us all happy.
Elizabeth Taylor's big treat was to be taken to the Welsh valleys. That's how he stunned her. And he went round saying, isn't it great? Look at these terrific people. This is my brother, this is my sister, this is my sister. This is where I had a drink. And he was very proud of it. And that's who she was going to marry, him and Wales, really. And she loved that.
They were a family of extraordinary nobility and style, not the nobility of ermine, but the nobility of dignity and courage. And he also had, which I expect you share, the passion of the Celt.
I mean, people often, you know, ask me about the fact that Richard came from the town, Tony Hopkins as well. And I always say that there is some kind of source of passion there. There's a sort of a dark energy.
Yes, indeed, absolutely. It's a good phrase. If you're a pure Celt, as Rich and you presumably are, there is no limit to the connection of the interior of the volcano and what emerges for the gaping public to admire and tremble at.
We declare him excommunicate and anathema. We cast him into the outer darkness. We judge him damned with the devil and his fallen angels and all the reprobate to eternal fire and everlasting pain.
Richard as Archbishop Thomas Becket in the newly restored film version of the play by Jean Anouilh. He was always quick to pay tribute to the people who had seen his potential and given their time to nurture it. Here he is at Oxford in 1967, at the height of his fame, recalling some of them, beginning with Meredith Jones.
One Welsh schoolteacher, I remember quite clearly what he said. He said, you do realise, don't you, that the 23rd Psalm is a great work of art. And that's what really first made me start thinking about words, because I couldn't understand why it was a great work of art. And then I started reading it. Of course, I knew it in Welsh. I still think it's more beautiful in Welsh than in English. And the second man was an Englishman called Burton, who, as you know, adopted me. And the third was Neville.
Neville was the Oxford Don Neville Coghill who'd first cast him in a play for the University Drama Society. The Englishman, Burton, was Philip Burton, a teacher from Port Talbot who taught him, adopted him, and gave him the name probably tempted you to listen to this programme. Robert Hardy again.
Sis was much relieved when Philip said, may I adopt him? And he taught him. the language of England and the language of Shakespeare, and from there was no stopping.
There's all these little touches which are almost mythical, but they happen to be true, that he and Philip would go up this hill, or mountain if you want to magnify it, behind the houses, and they would walk further and further apart, and he would ask Burton to keep talking, keep reciting lines of Shakespeare, and so that he could clearly hear it at further and further distances. So he had his own peculiar training.
I know that hillside well, and yes, Melvin, it is a mountain. It's just above where my parents live now. And that story's well known. Another layer of the myth and magic which is Burton's legacy in that part of the world. Philip Burton, the man doing the drilling and unlocking Shakespeare for this brilliant but, by all accounts, wild boy, spoke about it some years later in a BBC talk.
All I knew for sure was that he had good looks and a strong personality. In the next 2 years of hard work, I was to be amazed and thrilled by revelations of quite unusual talent. Most notable was his feeling for poetry and language. For instance, he discovered Dullan Thomas before I did.
And nightly, as I rode to sleep, the owls were bearing the farm away. All the moon long I heard, blessed among stables, the nightjars flying with the ricks and the horses flashing into the dark.
In those early years, the acquisition of acting technique was for him a painful and difficult process. But he learned with an astonishing thoroughness.
When we have matched our rackets to these balls, we will in France, by God's grace, play a set shall strike his father's crown into the hazard. Tell him he hath made a match with such a wrangler that all the courts of France will be disturbed with chases. And tell the pleasant prince, this mock of his hath turned his balls to gunstones, and his soul shall stand sword-charged for the wasteful vengeance that shall fly with them. For many a thousand widows shall this his mock out of their dear husbands, mock mothers from their sons, mock castles down, and some are yet ungotten and unborn, that shall have cause to curse the dauphin scorn.
Burton in Shakespeare's Henry V, and no doubt at one time or another that speech echoed down the valley to Taibach. In 1944, Philip helped Richard get a place at Oxford University as part of a short course split between scholarship and military training, the RAF in Richard's case. There he came across an equally passionate young actor-scholar from an entirely different background, Robert Hardy.
I met him at some Oxford theatrical do, and we absolutely loathed each other. And I thought, there's an arrogant sod. And he thought I was a prissy English whatever, you know. And we absolutely hated each other, and we didn't get at all together until one day, quite soon, actually, we were poring over a map in our uniform guys in navigation class. And each of us, we were thrown together, and we were extremely cool towards each other. And suddenly, at the same moment, we spotted on the map the River Trent. And one of us, I forget which, said, "See how this river comes me cranking in and cuts me from the best of all my land, a great half-moon, a monstrous cantle, out." And the other responded immediately, without a word else, "I'll have the currents in this place dammed up, and here the smug and silver Trent shall run in a new channel, fair and evenly." And we looked at each other and realised that we shared something quite extraordinary at the age of 18 to be able to quote and follow on from Hotspur in Henry IV, Part One, and that is how we got to like each other.
And so what sort of a figure did he cut?
A highly dangerous figure.
My first feeling when I arrived, of course, was absolute terror, because suddenly I think, only my second time in England, even alone at Oxford. But generally, the people from the better schools treated me absolutely as an equal. And I had no problem at all. I blacked a few eyes in the first 3 weeks or something.
Anybody on whom he turned his blue gaze was riveted. The fury of him when he was furious, and the sadness.
It's that sadness that's always intrigued me. I see it in the best of his film roles. When he played Jimmy Porter in Look Back in Anger, a part I played on stage a few years ago, he seemed to me to be at his best when his Jimmy's anger was reined in, subdued, almost melancholy. As a performer, you always admire and try to avoid someone else's interpretation in equal measure, but he taught me a lot about the different ways to deliver power.
For 12 months, I watched my father die when I was 10 years old. He'd come back from the war in Spain, you see. All my mother could think was that she was married to somebody who was on the wrong side in all things. Perhaps she pitied him. But I was the only one who cared. He would talk, you know, pour out all that was left of his life to a small, frightened boy who could barely understand half of what he said. All I could feel was the despair and the bitterness, the sweet, sickly smell of a dying man. See, I learned at an early age what it is to be angry. Angry. Helpless.
Look Back in Anger came out in 1959. It was very early in his career, but by that point he'd already made his name on the West End stage and at Stratford-upon-Avon. It really kicked off for him in London with a small part in a play by Christopher Fry, The Lady's Not for Burning, alongside the already legendary Sir John Gielgud.
He arrived, first rehearsal, and just walked into the part. I never had to tell him anything except to stop yawning and when it was lunchtime, because he was so anxious to get away. But he had the most wonderful instinct immediately. Then I did The Boy with the Cart with him, in which he gave a beautiful performance at Hammersmith, in which he was very proud. It was a sort of folk play of Christopher Fry's, which had been done, I think, by amateurs before, and he loved it.
Gradually, I was aware of someone in the doorway and turned my eyes that way and saw, carved out of the sunlight, a man who stood watching me, so still that there was not other such stillness anywhere on the earth, so still that the air seemed to leap at his side. He came toward me, and the sun flooded its banks and flowed across the shadow. He asked me why I stood alone. His voice hovered on memory with open wings and drew itself up from a chine of silence as though it had long time lain in a vein of gold. I told him, "It is the King Post." He stretched his hand upon it. At his touch, it lifted to its place. There was no sound. I cried out, and I cried at last, "Who are you?" I heard him say, "I was a carpenter."
The theatre critic Harold Hobson said of Burton in that role that he seemed to bring his own cathedral on the stage with him. That cathedral, part voice, part presence, that's a legacy you can still find in many of his best films and recordings. By now he was married to his first wife, Sybil, and he was starting to earn and earn well. Next up, thanks to the actor-director Anthony Quayle, was starring roles with the Royal Shakespeare Company at Stratford-upon-Avon, including Henry V, which he did again in London at the Old Vic.
Richard was always kind enough to say I took a big chance on him, but I didn't think I took all that big a chance. I thought that there was no question that he not only could do it, but he could do it triumphantly, and that he was going to be a great, huge, thumping star. It was perfectly obvious.
We few, we happy few, we band of brothers, for he today that sheds his blood with me shall be my brother. Be he ne'er so vile, this day shall gentle his condition. And gentlemen in England, now abed, shall think themselves accursed they were not here, and hold their manhoods cheap, whilst any speaks that fought with us upon St. Crispin's Day!
And now, he is the theatre, the recently opened Richard Burton Theatre, at the Royal Welsh College of Music and Drama. Hilary Boulding is the college principal.
There's this extraordinary legacy, which you know all about, of these actors, great inspiration actors, all coming from the same area, this very small community that's produced great actors. And it just seems to fit like a glove. And part of what our students love is discovering the theatre, because they're treading in great shoes. So, you know, it's one of those things where you look for the connections and there are more and more. Mm. But I don't think you can take away from just how inspirational it is for a young actor to have in mind someone in whose footsteps they're wanting to tread.
There's something else going on as well. Richard Burton's and Anthony Hopkins' success has made acting a perfectly reasonable, even noble ambition, even amongst a load of sports-mad boys. I felt it performing in Welsh Youth Theatre. And later on, I remember my first big performance for the Royal Shakespeare Company, playing Henry V at Stratford-upon-Avon, feeling when I looked out at the curtain call, with most of the audience standing up, and realising that it was half of Puttalbert there for me. I think that's the Burton legacy too. Barry Norman believes it was his early film success that did for his theatre career, a success that brought enough wealth to force him abroad, out of the clutches of the 90% tax rates of the time.
Yeah, the money was very important, because it came to him very early. He had a 7-year contract with one of the big Hollywood studios when he was, you know, really very young. And then when that contract came to an end, he'd got the taste for that kind of fame and that kind of money, and he wanted more of it. And this culminated, of course, in Cleopatra and the huge romance with Elizabeth Taylor, which suddenly rocketed him to huge international stardom, which he hadn't enjoyed before. He was on the way to stardom, but he hadn't been that big. But the two of them together were the biggest thing in the show business world. And from that moment on, I think he was lost.
Lost or made? Take your choice. But before Liz Taylor and Cleopatra, there was yet another talent he had to unleash on Broadway. Burton, the singer.
It's true. It's true. The Crown has made it clear. The climate must be perfect. All the year. A law was made a distant moon ago here. July and August cannot be too hot. And there's a legal limit to the snow here in Camelot.
And this is where the stories of the Burton legend really take off. There was Burton's Bar, a sort of drinking den in his dressing room. Several times, some say almost every night, he was tanked up by the time the curtain rose, and yet no one, not even his co-stars, could fault his performances. Meanwhile, his reputation with the women, already well established in spite of what was clearly a close marriage with Sybil, added a whole new layer of irony to one of the show's most famous numbers.
How to handle a woman? There's a way, said the wise old man. A way known by every woman since the whole rigmarole began. Do I flatter her? I begged him answer. Do I threaten or cajole or plead? Do I brood or play the gay romancer? Said he, smiling, no indeed.
He did, you know, betray an awful lot of women. But they knew what was coming. I mean, his track record was there it was. It was not exactly a secret. The sort of madness of the man was completely beguiling. I mean, true stories, like being on a set with a very classy actress and being asked to walk down the street with her in a scene and just keeping on walking, getting in a car around the corner and not coming back for 2 or 3 days. He did that sort of thing.
Richard left Camelot to take up the role of Mark Antony in the already hugely overspent production of Cleopatra in 1961. Liz Taylor was a massive star, the great Hollywood beauty, with a record of marriage breaking already behind her. Then and since, the world has had a field day with their romance. Le scandale, Richard dubbed it. American senators sought to ban them. They were damned by the church. And worst of all, for Richard, his close friends and family were appalled, siding with Sybil and thinking of the two children, Kate and Jessica. It made no difference.
How to handle a woman? Mark me well, I will tell you, sir. The way to handle a woman is to love her. Simply love her, merely love her, love her, love her.
One of the awful, awful times was when he left Sybil. And we'd known and loved Sybil, who forgave everything, until he left her.
Everybody loved Sybil. Sybil was,
you know, part of the family, one of my mum's best friends. And my mother hasn't seen her since. Sybil sent her a letter when Dad died, and that was the last time.
Guy Masterson. Like it or not, this part of the Burton story is still immense. I look at it from a very long way off, with awe at how either partner survived for as long as they did in such a blaze of publicity. The best insight I've heard came at Burton's memorial service in 1984 from his old friend, the playwright Emlyn Williams, the man who had first cast him in a film, The Last Days of Dolwyn. Williams gave his eulogy as a conversation with Burton himself.
I remembered that I had introduced you to dear Sybil and that I was godfather to little Kate. And I flew to Rome. I was met by my delinquent friend, and as he drove me to the studios, we talked of this and that, but not of it. Then, bump, he stopped the car and looked at me. I was about to embark on my lecture when he said, oh, I shall never forget this. He said very calmly, Dwi am briodi renneth ma, which is the Welsh for, I am going to marry this girl. Dwi am briodi renneth ma. As you well knew, Richard, the fact that you said it in Welsh proved to my Celtic instinct that you were going to marry this girl. But even a Celtic instinct could hardly have foreseen that you were going to do it twice.
You might think everything had been said or written about Taylor and Burton, Liz and Dick, Laurel and Hardy, they sometimes called themselves. In fact, it's Taylor's side of the story that's the least familiar. And she was only persuaded to help Nancy Schoenberger and her partner with their new book when they told her a story about Richard's dwindling reputation in the States.
We mentioned to a young drama student that we were writing a book about Elizabeth Taylor and her marriage to Burton. And her response was, oh, I didn't know Elizabeth Taylor was ever married to Tim Burton. Nothing against Tim Burton, who's a wonderful director, but when this story was told to Dame Elizabeth, she said, oh, it's really happening. Richard Burton is being forgotten. And it's really to her credit, because she went against her own sort of dictum not to talk about that relationship in order to make sure that Richard Burton's name is out there again and that we see him as the full, passionate, intelligent, talented man that he was.
Mary, I know from the book that she actually gave you permission to publish some of the letters he sent her over the years. What did you make of them when you first read them?
I'll tell you, when I first saw the letters and I started to read them, I didn't expect this reaction, but tears sprang to my eyes because they are so moving and so heartfelt and so passionate. In one letter he writes, the French have a word for what I am, and it's called manqué, meaning failure of desire. I am everything manqué, an actor manqué, a philosopher manqué, a writer manqué, and consequently an intolerable bore. Not manqué, I'm afraid. He writes in another letter, you asked me to write the truth about us. This is after their first serious breakup before their first divorce. I suffer from a severe case of hubris.
An overweening pride. Prometheus was punished by the gods forever and is still suffering in all of us for inventing fire and stealing it from the gods. I am forever punished by the gods for being given the fire and trying to put it out. The fire, of course, is you. In Wales, the pictures are still there, of Burton and Taylor. And it all seems very brash and flash and a bit beyond reality, really. So it's nice to catch glimpses of a more genuine, private relationship. Barry Norman once saw it too, when he took Burton for a pint after an interview.
We bellied up to the bar and had a pint of bitter each. And as we were drinking it, he suddenly turned to me and said, do you know, I have never once been unfaithful to Elizabeth. Now, I mean, I don't know why he said that. It certainly wasn't in response to a question from me. I mean, God, what was I going to say? Hey, Richard, how often have you been unfaithful to Elizabeth? You can tell me. I'm a journalist, you know. I mean, he just volunteered this information. And I believed him, you know, because there was no reason for him to say it otherwise. Yes, there were rumours around that he'd of his infidelity, but there are rumours about everybody's infidelity, and most of them are groundless. And I think in his case, most of those rumours were groundless.
I cried for madder music and for stronger wine, but when the feast is finished and the lamps expire, then falls thy shadow, Sinara, the night is thine, and I'm desolate and sick of an old passion, yea, hungry for the lips of my desire. I have been faithful to thee, Sinara, in my fashion.
No one doubts that it was true love. I don't doubt that it was true love. I also don't doubt that he loved Sybil as fully as he could do, and he never stopped loving her either. And then he never stopped loving Susan, you know, but that's what he was. He was all-giving, all-passionate.
Guy Masterson. Susan was Richard's third wife. Sally Burton was his fourth.
I sort of came to a realisation that he needed different people at different stages of his life. What I'm talking about, of course, is different wives. I was never in any doubt that he loved me, and he certainly held his other wives in great respect. And he had loved them. He'd loved them all. And I think he enjoyed loving people. He had a lot of love to give, and my goodness, he gave it. But yes, I mean, there was the volcano underneath.
The volcano seems to have been a recurring theme for all who knew him. It was at its most volatile when drink was at hand, and there was a staggering amount of that in the 60s and 70s. He talks often in his diaries about being sloshed or sozzled. We'd use harsher language now. And he was no angel. Robert Hardy.
There was always a danger of what drink and the fury and the inner rage and so forth would do, and he could be frightful to other people and frightful to himself when the alcohol took charge.
I think that Richard had a predilection towards alcohol anyway. It was in the family, his father. Daddy knew he was an alcoholic. It probably runs back generations.
It was with a lot of those men, especially the men who worked very physically, it was A, something that they needed to stop dehydrating, a few pints, just they'd been down the mines, and it became almost heroic to drink a lot. And it was stupid, yes, but there was something else about it. It was to do with what you could do. It was an expression of your freedom. All that was important to Burton. I think one of the things I liked about him was that he carried his past with him.
I found it rather interesting to discover, for instance, that for about 5 years, I didn't quite remember what films I'd done or anything. And I ran into a chap after I'd become a good boy and sobered up. I saw a very distinguished actor at the party, and I went over and I said, I've admired you for so many years, I'm so glad to meet you. And he was an American, and he said, Kid, we did a film together. It lasted 4 months. And I said, well, thank you very much.
And there he is in the late 1970s on Welsh TV doing what he did best, telling stories. There are other ideas about why he drank. High on the list is a notion of guilt. Guilt over breaking his first marriage, over a failure to help out the cash-strapped poet Dylan Thomas towards the end of his short life. And chief among them, guilt at not fulfilling his potential as an actor. Barry Norman.
He became a big movie star, but he could have been a great actor, and that is very different and is much more rare to be a great actor. And he had it within him to be a great actor, and he didn't. I think almost deliberately he chose not to go that route. People still talk about him as a great actor, but I think they're wrong. I think he was potentially a great actor who never quite made it.
Barry was one of the few confident enough to put that to Burton face to face. Another was an interviewer at that press conference in Oxford in 1967. Elizabeth Taylor was there with him to talk about their film of Marlowe's play Dr. Faustus, with Taylor playing the non-speaking role of Helen of Troy. Perhaps that resulted in a certain amount of pent-up energy.
Do you ever regret having moved into the commercial cinema?
Oh, excuse me, Richard, that makes me so angry. Because he has not left the stage. That's absolute bloody rubbish. Well, last year, he just got through doing a thing here for Oxford on the stage. The year before that, what was he doing on Broadway? That was the stage. But how can you say he's left the
because
stage?
Because that is not a continuous stage career in the sense that, for example, Paul Scofield or Laurence Olivier.
He's not continuous either on the stage. He does film appearances for money.
He was marked down, everybody said, into both his ears. You are the next Olivier. You are the follow-on. You must run the theatre in London. I think it drove him mad because he was a terrible joker apart from anything else. And he used then to slide into sort of Olivier speak, you know, and say, that is not me. I am no pantomime.
He did make a lot of bad movies, and he knew it. But at one point, he was supporting 42 people, including his entourage, and sending money back to his brothers and sisters and their families in Wales. At one point, he said, "For the money, we will dance," as a way of explaining some of the lesser films.
Mary Schoenberger. And the notebooks bear all that out, as well as making it clear that he was in control of income and expenditure, however lavish. His was never going to be the story of an actor duped by advisers and bad investments. So, let's turn instead to the best of the films. Melvyn Bragg.
Thank God he made films, I think. You could have a respectable season of Richard Burton's greatest hits, and they would be great, and they would be hits, and they would be worth showing anywhere.
And now, for me, it never stops. The voice of Equus, out of the cave. Why me? Why me? First, account for me.
The playful side of him is probably defined by the scene with Elizabeth in Taming of the Shrew.
Thou canst not frown, thou canst not look askance, nor bite the lip as angry wenches will. Nor hast thou pleasure to be cross in talk, but thou with mildness entertain'st thy wooers, with gentle conference soft and affable. And will you, nill you, I will marry you.
I'd rather die!
He used to talk about how much he owed to Elizabeth Taylor, because she told him that you must remember that when you're in close-up, your face is 40 foot high on the screen, so don't do things, think things.
The one in everyone's Burton top 10, including perhaps the best qualified to judge, film critic Barry Norman, is another with Liz Taylor as his co-star. Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf? Was written by Edward Albee and directed by a young Mike Nichols.
A storming performance, brilliant, brilliant performance. Much better than Taylor's, much better than anybody else's in the film. And that's where you saw it, you know, where you saw all this power and talent that he had unleashed.
You can sit around with the gin running out of your mouth, you can humiliate me, you can tear me to pieces all night. That's perfectly okay, that's all right.
You can stand it.
I cannot stand it.
You can stand it. You married me for it.
It was an act of love, that. If you see the film, as often as I've seen it, what's happening is he's making her a better actress. And he makes her a better actress by rushing her.
Aren't you something?
Well, I've got to find some way to get at you.
You've got at me. You don't have to do anything, George. 1,000 years of you has been quite enough.
You go quietly, then?
He knows that underneath there's a real raunchiness about her and a bitterness about her. And he's going to get that. He's going to get the performance out of her, which he does.
There is no moment. There is no moment anymore when we could come together.
Yeah, well, maybe you're right. You can't come together with nothing, and you're nothing. Snap!
Perhaps to my generation and even today's youth who might be surprised to see a Burton film in black and white, he lives on as the narrator voice in Jeff Wayne's concept album, War of the Worlds. I think they call that rain. On the late John Donne show here on Radio 2 some 20 years ago, Wayne recalled how he'd signed Burton up for the job, and listen out for the Burton reputation even then.
The first voice that came about in our minds, who had absolutely been perfect for it, was Richard Burton. And we were very fortunate in that we were able to locate him in New York, because he was playing in a play called Equus. Mm. We sent him the working script at the time and a letter explaining precisely how we were going to go about recording the work. And to our astonishment, he replied immediately and said, yes.
Did you have to offer him very large sums of money? Or
no.
Was he just happy to do it?
Very much in perspective. I mean, he didn't work for free.
No.
But he did
no.
work in perspective to the budget. And to my amazement, the speed in which he worked, the entire two albums that of his contribution was done in one day and about 3 hours of a second day.
You can imagine them punching the air in the recording booth as one of the great voices of the 20th century turned the narrator's role from functional link man to mesmerizing hero.
I marched recklessly towards the Titan and saw that a multitude of black birds were circling and clustering about the hood. I began running along the road. I felt no fear, only a wild, trembling exultation as I ran up the hill towards the motionless monster. Out of the hood hung red shreds at which the hungry birds now pecked and tore.
Well, if you're looking for the Burton legacy, there are still plenty of places to find it. There's film, of course. There's the memories of those who saw him in the theatre. And he has his share of monuments in Switzerland and Wales. But there's a good case for saying that it's the sound of that voice which still burns the brightest. And so it's all the more appropriate that you can find a picture of him here. I'm standing in the front stairwell of Broadcasting House in London, a place from which his voice was broadcast often in poetry and dramas. The picture has him holding a crown. There are those eyes as well. You talk about the voice, but Burton's eyes, those steely eyes, that kind of soulfulness. But a face that could turn to melancholy as quickly as it could turn to lacerating, visceral anger. It's wonderful to be able to see a picture of him here at the BBC, where so many extraordinary recordings emanated from.
Only you can hear the houses sleeping in the streets in the slow, deep, salt and silent, black, bandaged night. Only you can see in the blinded bedrooms the combs and petticoats over the chairs, the jugs and basins, the glasses of teeth, thou shalt not on the wall, and the yellowing dicky bird watching pictures of the dead.
Under Milk Wood, which was written by Dylan Thomas with his own booming style in mind for the part of the first voice. In the event, his death in America in 1953 from pneumonia meant it was his actor friend, Burton, who was left to conjure this little Welsh fishing village into broadcasting immortality. In a life of marriages, maybe this was the perfect one.
From where you are, you can hear in Cockle Row in the spring, moonless night, Miss Price, dressmaker and sweet shopkeeper, dream of her lover, tall as the town clock tower, Samson syrup, gold-maned, whacking-thighed and piping hot, thunderbolt-based and barnacle-breasted, flailing up the cockles with his eyes like blow-lamps and scooping low over her lonely, loving, hot water bottle body.
I think all my brothers have the same sort of basic voice. The timbre is the same and all that. I think our voices were born with coal dust and rain and some sort of authentic mystery from those dark and tortured valleys.
I'm not alone in thinking that at times the beauty and power of his voice allowed him to coast, to not quite give of his best. But when it mattered to him, he made the good great and the great magisterial.
What a piece of work is a man. How infinite in faculty, in form, in moving, how express and admirable in apprehension, how like an angel in movement, how like a god, the beauty of the world, the paragon of animals. And yet to me, what is this quintessence of dust?
The glory days of Richard Burton seem to have gone by the 1980s. The drink and a terrible back condition that eventually required surgery took their toll. But with the drink under control, he did regain a kind of equilibrium towards the end of his life. He was able to appear in a TV drama with his actress daughter Kate, to perform Camelot again, and to meet and marry his last wife Sally, with whom he enjoyed some well-earned tranquility and reflection. While convalescing from one operation, he accompanied his nephew, Guy Masterson, on a memorable road trip from London to his home in Switzerland in a Mini Cooper. They were golden weeks for the younger man.
I felt that I knew him. I felt his pain. I felt his anguish. I also sensed that what it was like not to belong to himself, to belong to other people, that he was always at the mercy of what other people wanted him to do. I remember sitting in that restaurant one night. This man in an opposite booth kept looking over and eventually plucked up the courage to go over and approached Richard, and he said, "Mr. Burton, I gotta tell you, I've been looking at you, and there's this thing I know about you, that you wear red on your person at all time, and I'm sorry, but me and my little lady here have been looking at you, and we can't see any red. So have we caught you out?" And Richard calmly looked at him for a while and reached down, took his beetle boot off, which with the zipper, undid it, and just showed him the lining. And it was red, bright red, Welsh red.
I can remember him saying once, "Why me?
Sally Burton."
And I think that was, why did he have that talent? Why he had come so far, done such a magnificent journey. And I think that at the beginning, it was all so exciting and so new. And that's why you see he crammed so much into those early years. He just had boundless energy. And that came from the enthusiasm of what he was doing and also the absolute wonderment, I think, of how far he could come.
You keep meeting person after person who say, "I saw him in that," as if they'd sort of seen Halley's Comet, you know. Mm. "I saw him in that. I saw Burton in that." So he had that, and that is, I'm sure some people will be able to work it out, but I think you could call it magnetism, and I think you wouldn't be misusing the word.
I'd seen it close up. People would stop what they were doing and follow him. We were walking through Paris, Montmartre, actually, and I turned, it was like this game that you play, that you turn around and people have to freeze. And every time I turned around, there'd be more people. And soon there were 50, 60 people just calmly following Richard Burton through the streets of Paris.
Would I have followed him? I probably would. Certainly if he turned up in Portalbert when I was a lad. It would have been even better to know him. But in August 1984, at the age of 58, Richard Burton died of a cerebral hemorrhage at his home in Switzerland. On his bedside notepad, he'd scribbled lines from Shakespeare. "Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow, and our revels now are ended."
How do you prefer to be treated by your fellow man? As an actor, as a star, as a producer, as a power, or as a man from the Welsh mining villages?
No, I prefer to be treated as a fairly interesting man with a fairly copious store of anecdotes.
Although he was buried in Switzerland, there were a number of commemoration services. Robert Hardy made sure that the biggest in London had the sound and feel of Pontre de Ven.
However far he travelled geographically or travelled in his career, he never really left Wales.
I think it was just a wonderful experiment, just to see how far he could take it. And it's possible that he went beyond where he thought he could possibly go.
It was undoubtedly extraordinary. Enough of that remains, I think.
Dominia de Bangalon, in Taili, in Pentre, like in Gwlad. Nadolig Shawen, a blwyddyn yw ddach I gyd.
What was that?
Well, I just wished my family, my village and my country a very Merry Christmas. And I have a very large family.
I remember him saying once to me, "Stick to your myth. We are the myth makers."
Robert Hardy. And that should be the end of it. Rich, the princely Welsh mythmaker. But there's one more thing I'd like to add, and it's something that I think answers some of the questions about Burton's wild and bullocking life. He was a man of extraordinary and powerful emotion, much of it felt by family, by wives, by friends, and by audiences. And he was also capable of reverence, not for great actors, although he admired them enormously, nor for world leaders who he met by the banquet full. No, his reverence was for writers, for Shakespeare, there, at his death, for Albee, for Peter Schaffer, for poets like Gerard Manley Hopkins. He wrote once in his notebook about the prospect of teaching English at Oxford. "I am thrilled
by the English language, as I am by a lovely woman, or dreams, green as dreams and deep as death. Christ, I'm off and running, and will lecture them until iambic pentameter comes out of their nostrils. Little do they know how privileged they are to speak and read and think in the greatest language invented by man. I'll learn 'em. And even in that piece, you can hear the man he served best of all, his compatriot Dylan Thomas. So here, for me, is the most enduring part of the Burton legacy. Of many readings, I've chosen one, the final stanzas of Poem in October, where the boyhood and the desire of poet and performer become one.
There could I marvel my birthday away, but the weather turned around. It turned away from the blithe country, and down the other air the blue altered sky streamed again a wonder of summer with apples, pears, and red currants. And I saw in the turning so clearly a child's forgotten mornings when he walked with his mother through the parables of sunlight and the legends of the green chapels and the twice-told fields of infancy, that his tears burned my cheeks and his heart moved in mine. These were the woods, the river and sea, where a boy in the listening summertime of the dead whispered the truth of his joy to the trees and the stones and the fish in the tide, and the mystery sang alive still in the water and singing birds. And there could I marvel my birthday away, but the weather turned around. And the true joy of the long dead child sang burning in the sun. It was my 30th year to heaven, stood there then in the summer noon, though the town below lay leaved with October blood. Oh, may my heart's truth still be sung on this high hill in a year's turning.
The Richard Burton Legacy was presented by me, Michael Sheen, and produced by Tom Alban.
This is BBC Radio 2, online, on digital, and on 88 to 91 FM.